Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Lord, as we come to you now, Father, we just thank you that we're born in a country that's free, that we're citizens may freely petition government, Lord, without retribution. And Father, I just pray that freedom will always and forever be. Father, I just thank you now for the life of Don Wilson that passed away recently this week, and what a friend he was to all of us. And Father, we just pray for his family now at the loss, Lord. Just pray that you would be with them. Father, I just pray now for your guidance as we attend to the people, those we serve, Father, and just guide us in the right direction, Lord, and may these decisions that this board makes be pleasing to you. These things I do pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. At this time, the Sheriff's Honor Guard is going to have the presentation of our colors, and also they will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Come. Yeah, please stand.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Sheriff Johnson.
Good evening, Commissioners. The honor to be before you tonight. We're going to show you a little bit what went on y'all allowed us to do in Washington, D.C., honoring our fallen law enforcement officers here in Alamance County. We could get started.
The greatest strength of law enforcement is that it's a family. Every federal law enforcement agency, police department, highway patrol, sheriff's department, or precinct is a family. A family that supports and protects each other in life and grieves for and honors the memory of those in death. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of your national leadership and on behalf of the greater civilian public, we say thank you. We will never forget your loved one, and we want you to know you are not alone.
Thank you.
This year, we pay tribute to 273 extraordinary individuals whose stories are a testament to the bravery, patriotism, and valor of America's law enforcement officers at every level, and whose names are now permanently carved into this memorial as a reminder of their supreme sacrifice. Engraved into these walls represent the best that America has to offer. And while the earthly lives of these brave and loving souls have been tragically extinguished, in the hearts of all of those gathered here today, the light that they brought to the world burns on.
Behind every name on these walls are stories and memories that illuminate us, burning brightly, tonight and every night. Stories that inspire us and memories that cannot be extinguished.
As we gather on these sacred grounds to honor courage and salute sacrifice, we are united by the flickering light of our candles and emboldened by the knowledge that America's thin blue line continues to shine clear and bright. We honor and remember those fallen heroes now and always, just as we honor and remember their surviving family members. To all of the survivors who have honored us with your presence here tonight, please know that your loved one will never be forgotten, and neither will you. As we raise our candles skyward in silent tribute, let us solemnly pledge to always remember and cherish those who have fallen, to support those who have been left behind, and to value those who continue to serve.
Okay, Faye, certainly we want to thank the commissioners and the people of Alamance County for allowing our honor guard to go and participate in the Washington, D.C. Memorial. We were invited, and we've been invited back next year. But we were there this year to honor George Jefferson Massey, whose name was added to the wall. And we have two of his family members here, Mr. Doug Massey and Miss Alma Massey. Mr. Doug Massey is grandson of Mr. George Massey. Miss Alma Massey is a granddaughter-in-law of Mr. George Massey. And they took the trip to Washington, D.C. to see their grandfather and grandfather's name added to the memorial. Alamance County has lost the most officers in the county, as you can see. Deputy Sheriff Jerry Gideon Davis was the last one, September 1st, 1970. He was killed by gunfire. We had Sheriff Marcellus P. Robertson killed December the 7th, 2 days after he was sworn in office at the Sprinkler Company robbery here in Alamance County. Deputy Sheriff Lawrence George Goins was killed July 31st, 1936 with gunfire. And last but not least, Mr. Deputy Sheriff George Jefferson Massey, whose family is with us today, was killed on March 4th, or died on March 4th, 1934. And you commissioners allowed us to attend this with the family, and we want to thank all of y'all, because they were one of the 200, or he was one of the 273 names added to that memorial this year. The video was just shown earlier out of order, but that brought it to that. This is our honor guard, which some of them you see here tonight, that stood guard at the wreath of the fallen officers there in Washington, D.C. at the memorial. This is Miss Alma Massey with our lieutenant. Miss Massey about killed all of our deputies that was there because she was in such physical shape. I think they walked 46 miles during the week there. So I'm going to send some of them back. Let's go back. Okay. Congressman Walker met with the Massey family at his office there in Washington, D.C. and talked with them, which I thought was very, very good for Congressman Walker. And the family learned a little bit about the standings in Washington, D.C. at that point in time. Right here, you can see this is called the honor cordon, two of our honor guards. You see the officer with the rose. Anybody, any department that lost an officer, someone in that department met them getting off the bus, giving them a rose and escorting the family into the ceremony. There were 20 busloads of surviving families of law enforcement officers killed this year, or 2014. And it was really something to see. You see a bald-headed sheriff right there. My wife and I took a pencil and took the names of our people off of the wall. This particular name was not Alamance County deputy, even though we did get deputies, but we're stood there. This is a young man that was killed from Virginia that was my son's partner that was killed in a drug raid there. And his name was added to the wall. This is where the memorial ceremony, they see the thin blue line. A lot of people don't know when they see the thin blue line. It is a symbol used by law enforcement. It originated in the United Kingdom and became prevalent in the United States and Canada to commemorate fallen law enforcement officers and to symbolize the relationship of law enforcement and the community as the protectors of civilians from the criminal elements. And this particular night, there was over 20-some thousand. As you can see, this is just part of them there at the ceremony candlelight vigil. Right there is one of our deputies. There's one of our deputies that was there. And this was something to see. And I'm telling you, cold chills was all over you during the entire ceremonies. This right here, as you see, says Sheriff's Office, Alamance County. This is one of the candles that was held at the vigil that night, the candlelight vigil. And this is honoring Deputy George Massey, whose name was placed on the memorial that particular night. And I certainly want to thank each and every one of you. This past year, 273 officers' names was added to that wall. 117 of them were killed in the line of duty in 2014. The others were added, sort of like Deputy George Jefferson Massey's name was added. And now there are over 20,538 total names on that memorial wall of officers that died in the line of duty in this nation to protect our citizens. And I would like to ask the masses anything you would like to say, either one of you.
Thank y'all very much.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
It's our privilege to do that.
I'm very proud of all the people that were with us. They were very professional and just treated us very good.
Thank you, Ms. Massey. We're proud of them too.
Yep.
Alamance County's got a great sheriff's department. All of us should be proud of
them. Thank you, Mr. Massey. Any further comments from the commissioner?
Sheriff, you may want to put her on your payroll to help get you guys in good shape.
Well, I'm telling you, I'm thinking about hiring her as you see it. Will you commissioners give me a position to hire her? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, we're going to start into our public speakers for the night, and we have nine that have actually signed up online, and then four that have signed up here. Let me just say this at the beginning. We'll be discussing, for the most part, probably those who have signed up an issue that is not on the agenda tonight because nobody has requested it to be on the agenda for tonight. Also, with that being said, I think it's important that the speakers, because it wasn't on the agenda, but the speakers that come before us tonight, not to discourage them in any way from speaking. Certainly, it's their right. This is their meeting. But just so they know where we as the commissioners stand, I think it's important that you know ahead of time, prior to, just how we stand. And with that, I would just like to ask by consensus, is there a single member here that reports, that is interested in moving or taking down our Civil War Memorial Monument at Court Square?
Not at this time.
Nope.
Not a single one, folks. So with that being said, thank you. That being said, now we will begin, and John Thorpe. John, come on up, sir. You have 3 minutes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely. We will wait. It'll be 5 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, John Thorpe. Some of you, or all of you, may know by now. On May 20th, 1861, North Carolina made the biggest and by far the most embarrassing mistake in the state's history. When we, the people, seceded from the greatest governmental idea in the history of the world. On that day, 14 years ago, we committed treason against the United States. At that point, we joined the class with the names of Aaron Burr and Benedict Arnold, serving a president that did not pledge his allegiance under the same flag that you, Commissioner, serve under. He did not believe in practice freedom or justice for all. The president we decided to serve was a president that said African slavery as it exists in the United States is moral, a social, a political blessing. That statement was made about my grandfather 6 generations ago. While you gentlemen see a piece of history for a teachable moment, blacks in this county see a great evil of injustice and damages the self-esteem and reminds them that in Alamance County, their family members' lives was worth 3/5 of a white man. Many wonder how the African Americans in this county do not believe in the justice system, and it's because we are immortalizing and paying homage to people who died only to oppress those who serve under someone that they call a master in front of the place where justice is supposed to be rendered. This is not ancient history, and this is not biblical times. This is 54,000 days ago. Besides the fact of glorifying treason and oppression and it be viewed as hatred, this is the ultimate degradation to the dead Union soldiers, and these men fought for you and me and every American so that we have the right to serve and live in America, so that you may be a commissioner, so that I have the right to speak to you as a citizen. Instead of thanking and paying our respects to them, we are commemorating the evil ones. We are lifting up and praising the ones who fought tooth and nail with every fiber of their being so that the American dream would never prosper, so that the Declaration of Independence will sit behind the Articles of Succession. And every moment that the sun shines on that statue, they are honoring those who did not want you to live in this country and disgracing those who made it that way. This is not about heritage. This is not about history. This is not about pride. This is the government that you took an oath to serve is a government set up by rebels, but the rebels that hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, and that land was set up by that exact same government and those rebels. These aren't the sentiments of me. These are the sentiments of thousands of your constituents. It's also not an issue that you should have to rule on. There is no doubt. You couldn't possibly understand how African Americans feel about that statue. But nor could I understand the passion that the pro-Confederate and pro-rebel people feel about that statue as well. And I'm not here to ask to take down a statue as it has been reported. But
thank you, John.
Okay, I'm almost done. Just one last statement.
Finish this sentence.
Okay.
One sentence.
But we're not asking for this statue to be taken down. We are simply asking you to open up a relations so that racial division, so that we can come together. Now is the time to come together. We don't want to continue to be separated out.
Thank you,
so
John.
If you do that, we will be extremely happy.
Thank you.
Thank
sir.
You.
Appreciate it. Wendy Duke.
There we go.
She may be
thank
in the back
sir.
Room.
What was the name again?
Wendy Duke.
Wendy.
Duke. Duke. D-U-K-E. Just in the mayonnaise or university. Yeah, I just put the food first.
Got to relate it to food. Yeah.
Jerry Wendy's brother, she said she'd come up and ask if we could switch. I don't know who she asked, but she said she asked one of you guys.
Talk to one of the staff.
I'm okay.
Go ahead, yeah, go ahead, sir. Fine. Go ahead, sir. And state your name again, please, sir.
Gary Williams.
Gary. All right. Thank you, Mr. Go ahead, Mr.
Well, thank you guys for allowing us to have this opportunity, first of all, and thank you for your overall vote to not remove our memorial. That being said, there's really not a whole lot to say after this, but still we're here, so I'm going to speak a few words anyway. It's got to stop being about race. It's got to stop being about race on everything that we do. That memorial's been out there for 100 years. If you want to keep dividing this country apart, keep talking about race and keep dividing us even more. Until this came up in the news, and I'm sorry for the folks in South Carolina that lost their lives, I feel sorry for them, that a psychopath is getting his way, is what is going on. And as far as this bandwagon that everybody jumped on to jump on the Confederacy, or the Confederate flag, or the monument, or whatever it may be, it needs to go away. As far as that goes, if you want, the concerned citizens would like to do something to progress this county, I'm sorry to say this, but as Mr. Jefferson said, let us be alone. Leave it alone. Move on. Find something else to do. Something more important that is productive for this county and not to keep ripping it apart. As far as that goes, thank y'all. And our monument's going to be where it needs to be.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. James Myron.
Yes, I just wanted to bring in a copy of the petition that we had signed. Mr. Engel has it. Currently 8,400 signatures in support of the monument staying. I appreciate your vote to keep the monument in place. It's what needed to be done. Pretty much anything else need to be said has already been said.
Thank you. Thank you again. Appreciate it. Janice McSherry. We'll check it back. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners, for allowing us to have a few moments of your time. First and foremost, I don't see that statue as a Confederate. I see that statue as a veteran of the United States military. By act of Congress, all Confederate Army, Navy, and Marines were made United States veterans. That man that I see standing there fought for every citizen that resided in Alamance County, every citizen that resided in the state of North Carolina, regardless of race or creed. And for that reason, I support you in not moving that monument. My father was a Second World War veteran. His brother was a Second World War veteran. My husband is a Vietnam era veteran. Veterans deserve every ounce of respect that we can give them, because without them, you nor I would be standing here today with the freedom to say what is on our mind, whether we are white, black, brown, yellow, red, or any other color. We are all one color under the God. Thank you.
Thank you. Mitchell Flinchum.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you tonight I'm representing Camp 813 of the local Sons of Confederate Veterans. Myself, my family, and my friends are not in favor of any attempt to remove the Confederate Memorial from its current location by the historic courthouse. I'd like to give you a few reasons why. As the previous lady stated, by Public Law 85-425, signed May 23, 1958, all Confederate veterans are made United States veterans. A Confederate veteran should therefore be treated with the same honor and dignity that any other American veteran would receive. If you tear down this monument, then you're destroying a piece of history and a place that honors those American veterans that paid the ultimate sacrifice. If it pleases the board, I would also like to note that under NC General Statute 100-2 and 100-3, no monument on public property can be moved without the approval of the North Carolina Historical Commission. I believe this would include the property that's in the state right-of-way. The design for that monument is called the Boy Soldier, and it was erected in 1914. The inscription on the base is the same as on the North Carolina Soldiers Monument at Gettysburg. It was not erected by the government, but the money for it was raised by private donations and donated by the local United Daughters of the Confederacy. It cost $2,100 in 1914. I'd like to offer a quote from the Bible that struck me on this. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 28 says, "Remove not the ancient landmarks which thy fathers have set." People need to remember why the memorial was placed, what era it commemorates, and why is it important. This monument was not erected as a symbol of hate or for the glory of the Confederacy. It was erected as a symbol of love for the fathers, the sons, the husbands, and the brothers that never came home. We cannot judge 19th century people by 21st century standards. Maybe it's high time we should all get past that. But who gets to decide what history needs to be erased? What's divisive, derogatory, bigoted, or racist? Which group matters the most? Since private funds were raised to erect that statue, do the concerned citizens of Alamance propose to raise money to have it removed? I would be opposed to spending public funds for this purpose, even if it were approved by the commissioners. Also, the question is, where would we move it to? Over the last several weeks, many monuments in our state have been desecrated or damaged in cemeteries. And this is one of the most heinous acts and is criminal in North Carolina, but it's still happening. So how could we protect it if it was moved? Over 1,100 men from Alamance County marched away to war, and over 300 of them never came home. This monument represents all the North Carolina troops from Alamance County, both black and white alike. We know of at least 13 black Confederates that were
thank you.
Granted a pension.
Thank you, Mr. Lewis.
But anyway, thank you very much.
Appreciate it, sir.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you. Mike. Michael Trollinger.
To the commissioners and citizens of Alamance County, I'd like to say to you all that I commend you for not falling to political correctness. I commend you for allowing the government as we have it, that men and women are still shedding blood every day to protect, for allowing that government to work. I commend the demonstrators who are courageous people who peacefully protested, rallied. It wasn't a protest, it was a rally in front of the courthouse and around Court Square. No buildings was burned, no rocks was thrown, no disparaging words of any kind were spoken. That was a peaceful rally for people standing up for their heritage, for their convictions, and for their beliefs. And I thank them for handling themselves in the manner in which they did. This country has a problem, and that problem is too many times we bend to political correctness instead of standing up on Christian principles. Now, I know that everybody in this room may not be a Christian, and that's okay. I am, and I'm proud of that. I still feel the tension as thick as butter that could be cut with a knife in this room, in this building tonight. I commend this young man for his views, for publicly stating how he felt. I commend the other young man that stood and spoke, and his values, his beliefs. But the only thing that's going to change this nation, not just this county, but this nation, is love. The Bible gives us two great commandments. First, that we love the Lord our God with all our heart, our mind, our souls. And then that we love each other as our neighbor. Unfortunately, there have been some travesties that covers the annals of history that none of us are responsible for. And we each one have the power within ourselves today to change this country, to change race relations for those who really, truly desire to change race relations in this country. Because we can treat each other with love and respect. I may not agree with everything that you stand for. I may not like every symbol that you decide to put on a t-shirt and wear, or every statue that stands in front of a courthouse or in a national monument. But I can show you respect. I can state my opposition with respect, with courtesy, and with love. If we come together and do what God has preordained for us to do in His Word, which is to love one another, love will cover a multitude of sin, a multitude of pain, and a multitude of crime. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Chris Fowl.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Yes, sir.
The definition of a monument is defined as a statue or other structure erected to commemorate famous or notable person or event. It is also defined as a building, structure, or site that has a lot of importance or interest. Monuments are symbols of our collective history. They are visible reminders of the past. Events that happened in the past do not always please everyone. They don't please me, they don't please you. We cannot erase history by removing those reminders of the past also. Taking away our Confederate soldier will not change the history. The soldier is there to remind us of the ones who fought and or died and are still serving our country. The Confederate soldiers are veterans just as any other soldier that fights to defend our country. Our society must remember and respect the symbols of our history. The remembrance and respect of the past allows us to better understand and look forward to the future. It's a little short here, but memorials are meant to remind future generations of the cost of our freedoms. So that's my two cents, and appreciate you hearing it.
Thank you. David Wright.
My name is David Wright. I live at 3812 Tartan Lane in Burlington. I appreciate this opportunity to talk to the Commission. I'm here to offer a fair and workable solution to this controversy about the Confederate Memorial. It would be a way to tell the whole story of our history and heritage, especially around the Civil War and its aftermath. I would propose that we keep the current monument to the Confederate soldiers, but at the same time adding one paid for by private donations on courthouse property to commemorate one of the most important events in our county's history. It was an event that occurred Saturday, February 26, 1870, right here in Graham, on Court Square. It was an event that resulted in a declaration of martial law in Alamance County, federal troops being sent into Alamance County, an investigation by the U.S. Senate, and a national media coverage up to and including the New York Times. The event I refer to is the lynching of Wyatt Outlaw. Wyatt was a former slave and a former Union cavalry soldier. After the war, he returned to Alamance County, got involved in Republican politics, came to the attention of Governor Holden, who appointed Wyatt one of the five town commissioners in Graham. Wyatt was a man who counseled reconciliation and peaceful change by way of the law and the ballot box. He did his best to tamp down calls for violent revenge against the actions of terrorist groups against the freedmen. For his pains, he was dragged from his house on North Main Street on that rainy Saturday night. He was taken to Court Square, and there he was lynched, hung by the neck until dead from an elm tree. The investigation of the incident determined that it was done by members of a Klan-like terrorist group, the White Brotherhood, coincidentally made up almost exclusively of former Confederate veterans. I want to state clearly, I do not think all Confederate soldiers were terrorists. I personally had four great-great-great-grandfathers who were Confederate veterans, three in the Army of Northern Virginia, one in the Army of Tennessee, and sadly, one of them was, in all likelihood, a member of the White Brotherhood. In light of these events, could we not honor the memory of someone like Wyatt Outlaw at the same time we honor the Confederate veterans? Think of it, a lawfully serving government official, who, by the way, was also a law enforcement officer, was lynched on Court Square, and almost nobody in Alamance County has heard of it. Let us, when telling the story of our history and heritage, tell the whole story. For as Benjamin Franklin said, half the truth is often a great lie. Thank you.
Thank you. Shane Roser.
Some literature for y'all, if I can get it to you.
Good evening, commissioners, distinguished guests, fellow veterans, and fellow citizens. My name is Shane Roser. I'm a resident of Graham. I'm a proud veteran of the United States Army and North Carolina National Guard. I represented Graham as a resident National Guardsman as part of the Honor Guard that led in 1994 and 1995 for the Graham Christmas Parade of our nation's colors. My brother is a disabled five-time Iraqi combat veteran who provides pest removal services to all of Alamance County. My grandfather, Jim Halsey, was a World War II veteran and served in this community for over 50 years. My great uncle was Bill Price, who built Hollyville Mall, among others. All of my family have lived and served in Alamance County over the last 150 plus years. I'm here to speak on their behalf, on behalf of all veterans, past, present, and future. I'm here to address the notion of removing or relocating the monument that currently stands high in front of Court Square to honor U.S. veterans. My purpose here today is to give this board and any future board members the legal teeth to reject any such motion. I should not have to remind any commissioner of their oath of office or duty to this community's past, present, or future. I've provided documents to remind everyone of federal and state law. First of all, let us review the status and definition of the Confederate soldier. Currently, U.S. Code Title 38, Part 2, Chapter 15, Subchapter 1, Subsection 1501, clearly defines, and I quote, "The term Civil War veteran includes a person who served in the military or naval forces of the Confederate States of America during the Civil War, and the term active military or naval service includes active service. This means that the monument high above Court Square is a U.S. veteran memorial with all rights and protections as any other veteran memorial. There is honor to veterans and those that died in active duty, period. Secondly, let us review North Carolina state law. North Carolina General Statutes, as was stated earlier, provides for protection of this in every light monument in the state. North Carolina General Statutes Chapter 100, that I've provided a copy of, addresses this very issue. Let us review a few passages. 109 reads, and I quote, "County commissioners may protect monuments when any monument has been or shall be erected, hereby be erected to the memory of our Confederate dead, to perpetuate the memory and virtues of our distinguished dead, if such monument is erected by the voluntary subscription of the people and is placed on the courthouse square. The Board of County Commissioners of such county are permitted to extend from the public funds of the county an amount sufficient to erect a substantial iron fence around such monument in order that the same may be protected. Furthermore, North Carolina General Statute 100-10 outlines the upkeep and funding of such monuments. Thirdly, let us look at the monument status as a historic landmark. The Historic Properties Commission right here in Alamance County has deemed the monument a historic monument and therefore giving it further protections from being removed or moved. Also, the actual landmark is sitting within the easement of the state of Highway 87 and thus makes it further protected from being removed.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
One more thing.
That's good. We
let me just say this. Yeah, and thank you for this.
The county attorney has every bit of that information that he's prepared to give to us tonight, and so we thank you for that information. But we have it, and
the
3 minutes is up. Thank you. We need to be expedient. Thank you, sir. All right. Next, we have Antonino Caminiti. Sir, I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Yes, you did.
Thank you.
Can you hear me all right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good. I'm a Trent's resident from New York, and my accent may sound different from yours, but it goes for you, too.
Thank God.
I'm back at it.
The reason I'm here is because I read an article in Times News about Mr. Graves, his objection to having the statue removed. Not objection, he wants it removed. Because he feels that it signifies the slavery that it represents. I want to let Mr. Graves know that this is my feeling. Slavery ended 150 years ago, and I think he should get over it. And he's worried about injustice to the blacks in this community and across the nation. There are things maybe should put effort into correcting such injustices as the amount of black-on-black crime in the various black communities, an average of 13 victims a day. 13 a day, every day. 13 today and 13 tomorrow and so forth. If you want justice, how about correcting that? It should be, black leaders in this country should try and correct that, but they haven't. Where's the outrage? Where's the demonstrations? I only hear crickets on that. And what about the dissolution of the black family in the various black communities? The fathers who father these children show no responsibility. Where's the justice in that? What have they done to try and correct that? Which leads to the violence in the schools. There's no parent in their community or their home to direct these youth to lead a good life, to have good education, but they failed in their ability to have good education. And also, they drop out of school. How can they get a good job without an education? No work history, no work ethic. All they know is to dress and act like a thug. Who's going to hire them? There's the injustice right there. And I think that's where Mr. Graves should direct his energies towards where these injustices. And now you may wonder what I'm talking about. Is this also has to relate to the statue. The statue should stay where it is. It's a representative of what our heroes have done in the past. Whether you agree with it or not in the history of it, it's still part of our history. Whether you agree with it or you don't like it, it's still there to learn from it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Next, we have Tony Cox.
He's back at home.
Is he here?
I love the hate in the room. In the name of God we trust. Where the transplant from New York, where was that in 2006 when you were adopting illegal unenforceable ordinances? Where were they at whenever you were charging people with class 3 misdemeanors, innocent people, and bring them down here to this room and persecuting them? It ain't just blacks, it ain't just whites, it's Americans. People hate, they hate. You know, I could hate, but God won't let me hate. Y'all know. You gonna just sit there like it never happened? Pathetic people. But you know, God's gonna deal with people. Beverly Kerr and Julius Kerr down there that you brought your law in here with. We see with them, don't we? Y'all's his buddies. You should have been checking them out. Touching them kids down there at a storybook farm. Praying to your God. That's a wicked God. Wicked. I used to believe we all had the same God, but we don't. Wicked people. It's amazing. People need to start doing some thinking. We're going to end up like them people over there on the other side of the pond, and we don't want to be like that. But what are we going to do? What are you going to do? Give us some more illegal ordinances? Enforce some more illegal ordinances? Hey, Speedway out there, did they get done like they did because you're his aunt?
His aunt?
That's it.
I'm yeah. not Goodbye. His aunt.
So you're calling? That's enough time.
Won't y'all sue me? Let's go to court.
Next we have Margaret Dammer.
I think I will wait
for
next meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Gavin. Thank you.
We have Bill Wolford.
Married to his son.
It's Bill. Bill here. Bill Wolford. Thank you, Mike.
Well. All right, first of all, thank you for letting me be here tonight. I just wanted to say to you that I, like the man from New York, am not from these parts originally. But the statue that is out there represents a memorial and to ignore history is to repeat it. So to remove this from the very, from the place that it's been set, for the reason it was set, to honor the dead. There's nothing on that statue that says anything with regards to racism, hatred. It's about honoring those who believed in a cause, whether it was the winning cause or the losing cause, is irrelevant. They believed in a cause, and they gave the ultimate sacrifice. So, I know that you all said you weren't going to do anything about it, but there was one person who said, for now. I would implore that one person who said, for now, to seriously consider that this is a monument to the war dead. And leave it there. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
That concludes our public speakers for the night. And ladies and gentlemen, what we do after the public speaking is the commissioners have the opportunity to respond. Who would like to be first?
I'd like to know who said for now.
I did.
What does that mean?
I'd be happy to explain it.
Go ahead.
First. All right. Talking. Well, first of all, I appreciate everybody's comments. And I'm not a really good student of history, but I sure have learned a lot of history these last couple of weeks since this has become an issue. When I said for now, if this community decided to come together and advocate for its removal, I wouldn't really have a problem with that. I could live with that. I don't think it ought to be destroyed, certainly, and I think it needs to be in a prominent place. But I am fine with it. It's just like it is for all the reasons that everybody that was a proponent for it has said this evening. This is a very contentious issue, of course, and there are different sides to this issue, and those were pretty well stated, I thought, pretty well tonight. And it's interesting that, I'm on Facebook, and I get a lot of posts that come in my news feed, and some of them say, y'all just need to read history, and if you read history, you'll understand that that statute needs to stay, and they'll cite all different kinds of quotes and references. And then there are other people that say, y'all need to understand history, but they'll cite different references and different quotes that tell a whole different story. So you just have to, you know, decide. A couple of weeks, well, just a week ago, I was with the county manager and a county commissioner from Lee County, and we were talking about the monument issue here in Alamance County, and he says, well, what about us? Our county's named after Robert E. Lee. What are we supposed to do? So, you know, where does it stop? And so I understand that. You know, there were some really good editorials in the papers this past week. The current issue of the Alamance News, a very excellent editorial, of course, arguing that the statue should stay. And then in the Times News, I thought Madison Taylor's editorial in Sunday's paper, yesterday's paper, was excellent, as was attorney Bob Martin's. And this has really influenced my thinking quite a bit. But the monument is a symbol, and as we've heard tonight, it's a symbol of valor, bravery, call to duty, history, and heritage. We've heard those words tonight. For others, it's a symbol of treason, oppression, slavery, and for a whole lot of others in this community that I've heard from, they really haven't thought too much about it one way or the other. So what I think needs to happen in our community, and this could lead to, you know, a change of thinking, it may not, but there needs to be more community dialogue. And I think it would be much more productive if our community dialogue would be more about race relations, racial disparities, and I'm talking about disparities of health, education, crime, and those sorts of things, fully understanding those disparities and including what their root causes are. The man from New York kind of opined some causes, perhaps, but I'm not so sure that those are the root causes of some of these disparities. If we would do that rather than focus on the symbol, I think we'd be better off as a community. Moving that statue, particularly when it's such a contentious issue like this, would be more to divide this community rather than to bring it together, and I really think we need to start coming together. So that's where I am on this issue.
I just want to comment and thank everybody for showing up tonight and speaking. It's great that we got people from both sides coming to talk, and that's what we're here for. That's what we want to do. We want to listen to everybody in our community, and Bob's right. We need to work on relationships for the whole community. Friday, our county attorney sent out a paper with some of the laws and so forth that had been done over the years, and one of them that caught my eye, very first thing, the 25th president of the United States, a former Union soldier, President William McKinley, by presidential decree in 1901, ordered that Confederate veterans were to be considered American veterans. And I didn't need to read any more, because they are American veterans, and we should respect them and honor them, and that's what this statute does. If we take that down, do we go over here and take down things that we disagree on the memorial wall over here? And where does it stop? I have to ask, where does it stop? And I appreciate it. I actually did come down to the rally a little bit Saturday, and I saw it in everybody's faces that they were very concerned about this, and I appreciate that. And thank you for showing up, and I think people are just a little bit fed up, Michael. I think you hit the nail on the head. There is some little bit of skepticism about government, a lot of things, but hopefully we can continue on the right path here and make it right. Thank you.
Okay. Judge, you have anything?
I have a lot I'd like to say, but so many of the speakers have already said it, and I don't want to repeat except to say, Bob, I have studied a little history since I majored in it and taught it at High Point College for a couple of years. And I have an ancestor who fought at Gettysburg and was in Pickett's charge and survived, luckily. He was from Stuart, Virginia. And I doubt if there was a single slave in Stewart, Virginia at any time, because most of the mountain counties and cities in North Carolina and Virginia did not believe in it, and they actually would not accept it. But my great-great-great-grandfather, whatever number he was, went into the Army. Now, when I was coming along, we had to go into the Army, too. It didn't matter whether we wanted to or not. We had to go in, and we knew we had to go in, and a lot of the troopers who died in that Confederate Army fighting in the Civil War were the same way. They weren't fighting for slavery. They weren't fighting for blacks or whites. They were fighting because they were called. And that's the way this country has been in every war. And I, for one, will tell you right now, I will never vote to remove that statue.
Neither will I. Because my grandfather was right in here with you.
I guess it's been, I don't know, Anna can tell me the exact date for the time of use. It's been, what, about 10 days since you called me maybe for the first story. And I was sitting at lunch with Sheriff Johnson, so he kind of caught me off guard, and she said, well, there's a group coming that wants to move your statue in Graham. I said, what in the world? And I said, well, I don't have a problem with that, Anna, you know, with the statue. I mean, it's been there since 1914. I just couldn't understand it. And when you look at that statue, here's one of the things that hasn't been discussed tonight. Now, we talked about those soldiers that died in the war and memorializing them. But think of this also, ladies and gentlemen. When we look at the World War II, and the Korean War, what's going on with our veterans right now? They're starting to pass on, aren't they? 1914 was about the same time period since the Civil War, when you think about it. So they were not only memorializing those that had been killed in the war, but also honoring those that continued to live that were aging out at that time. And so I'm sure, you know, there was such a tragedy. When you look at that war and not only just the carnage for this nation, both sides, this great nation, the carnage, but also the injuries, the total numbers that came home without arms and legs, that lived their lives, that raised their children, that worked their fields, all those things. These are the people that were still living, that they were memorializing at that time. That's what was going on. That's what they were doing. It would be just like us if we have a grandfather or great-grandfather just passed away that fought in Korea, or just like my dad did, and I will get to him in just a second. We think about them and we honor them. That is why we have that statue sitting down here. Now, if you go over to Springwood Church Cemetery in eastern Guilford County, and you look at, there's a grave marker there. Jesse Carson Engle, he died in 2005. And he was a history major, Judge, just like you. He loved history, but On that headstone, you'll see direct descendants, Captain Barney Miller, American Revolution. You'll see George Engle and David Engle, Confederate States of America. And it's a part, when you look at what's going on here, it is honor, it is history, and it is heritage. And we have a responsibility, all of us. By what you're talking about, and healing old wounds, certainly we need to always endeavor to do that. As fellow Americans, we need to do that. But we also need to preserve our history and our heritage for our future generations that are coming after us, so that they'll know that, look, our founding fathers in this great nation, they set aside the issue of slavery because they wanted to found this nation. And those 13 colonies might not have all came along if that didn't happen. And it took a civil war before, Michael, the freedom of the slaves. It took that civil war. So if we do away with the monuments, how can I take my grandson and tell, you know, without looking in a book or going online, I can show him what a Southern officer, what a Southern soldier looked like. It's perfect, a perfect depiction. This is the weapons that they use. I can explain to him the Civil War and why it happened and also that this statute is here to memorialize those, your forefathers, that fought in that particular war. And it just said, I'll never vote to move it either, folks, but that's my feelings, and I've had my say. Thank you.
All right, let's move on.
All right, we'll move on. Consent agenda, there's a couple things we need to take out of the consent agenda. If you look, at the item number two, jury commission, Stephen Mullis, and then item number three, Alamance County Local Emergency Planning Committee, Roger Manuel. Both of those gentlemen need to just fill out a little more information. Folks, I've had a request for a 2-minute break, so we'll take 2 minutes. We'll take a couple minutes.
For those that want to leave, you're welcome.
Those that want to leave,
and the ones that don't, it's fine, you stay.
Thank you.
And I need to go.
right, Commissioners, approval of consent agenda has amended with the removal of Roger Manuel and Stephen Mullis to appointments. They will be, there was just some typos on their applications that will be repaired, and we'll vote on them in August. So that's, do I have approval of the consent agenda as amended?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All right, moving to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. All right, next we have presentations, other business. Number one is the request to set two public hearings on economic development incentives. Mac Williams. Welcome, Mr. Williams, President of our Alamance Chamber of Commerce.
Good evening, Commissioners, and thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. I've been working the last couple of months with a couple of industries that are considering Alamance County for investments and in operations. One of them that you know, and one of them that perhaps you don't know. As is the custom and the requirement of this board, I'm here to ask tonight that you can that you set a date for the public hearing for some incentives that have been offered, and also to tell you the names of the companies that are involved. You know one of them. They've already acted in Mebane on NIPRO. They would be now asking for the county commissioners to consider their request and would like August the 3rd to be the date for that public hearing. As has been reported, the investment for NIPRO would be a $17 million investment and 75 new jobs. Secondly,
so move.
The second project also would be hopefully if you approve it the night of August the 3rd. This one would be done on the same day because we would do the county meeting first and then go to Mebane the same night. And this will be a project for GKN. GKN has been rapidly growing of late, and they have a new operation that they want to relocate, and Alamance County is a consideration for the relocation of an existing operation someplace else. They would relocate it here and add some new jobs as well. So my request to you is to set August the 3rd for the dates for public hearings for both GKN and NIPRO.
And we have a any comments or questions?
How many? I didn't hear you say on the GKN. How many jobs are they proposing?
Well, again, the you all's requirement doesn't require me to say that to give details of the projects now, but I'm happy to do that. It's 26 jobs. 13 would be relocated and 13 new created. And the investment about $7 million for the GKN project.
We do have a motion from Commissioner Smith. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you for your support. We'll see you August the 3rd.
August 3rd at 9 a.m.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
all right.
Those are two excellent companies.
Yes, sir. Yes. Sheriff's Office and ACC Inmate GED Program, Sheriff Johnson.
Good evening again, Commissioners. You know, as we look at our people in our detention center, we have a whole lot of people there that did not graduate from school, that got involved in crime, and because of that, could not support themselves, and the recidivism rate is tremendous with those people. And Kurt Puckett, who's with our office, did some research and talked with Alamance Community College, and we've come up with a program. It's called Forging a Partnership to Advance Knowledge and Transform Lives. And the only way we're going to be able to do that is to get some of these inmates that did not finish high school and is wanting to have a better life to be able to show the outside world that they are trying to change their lives. And at the detention center, we're doing a GED program. We have partnered with the Alamance Community College in doing this. Fact, inmates who receive general education before release are more likely to find employment than peers who did not receive such opportunities. And I feel like as Sheriff of Alamance County, it is my duties to try to help these individuals if we possibly can. The overall goal of implementing GED program in the Alamance County Detention Center is to prevent recidivism. Believe me, if we can touch two lives, we've saved a ton of money for Alamance County. Positive results of a GED program are many, but those having a direct impact on our community include reduction of the local inmate population and creating job prospects that may otherwise not be available. If you are a person that owns a business and you know an inmate has come out of Alamance County Jail, and that individual has worked while he was in jail to get his GED degree, would you not feel more like hiring him than if he went in there and sat on his kazoo for 3, 4, 5 years or months? And that's what we're trying to do. Fact, inmates have among the lowest academic skills and literacy rates of any segment of society. Selection criteria. First of all, entry into our program is strictly voluntary. Those expressing entry must take a pre-entry test administered by ACC, which has already been completed. Eligible inmates are those who have been convicted of misdemeanor crimes and received a court-mandated sentence of at least 1 year. Because of the amount of time it takes, that has to be 1 year or longer. Inmates may not have had any disciplinary problems in jail, or we don't take them. Priority is given to inmates who score below a high school literacy level, and are residents of Alamance County. We're keeping inmates that are not citizens of Alamance County. They are not eligible to go in this program. Just Alamance County citizens, because we're the ones going to be hit if they go back and reoffend. Fact, approximately 1 in 6 jail inmates dropped out of school because of their involvement in illegal activities. And so help me, that is true. Budget. Through the State Criminal Alien Assistance Program, SCAP, the state of North Carolina pays Alamance County approximately $55,000 per year to be used for direct services to inmates. ACC will provide one instructor, which they have, and all the materials needed to carry out the class. Off-duty detention officers will be contracted to provide security for each class twice weekly for 2.5 hours. We have to have a detention officer with these inmates, period, paragraph. ACC will invoice the Sheriff's Office monthly for its services and will be reimbursed from the state provided funds, from the provided funds described above. Fact, inmates have among the lowest academic skill and literacy rate of any segment of society. Demographics of our inaugural class, we have 11 males and, hold on a minute, I got the ranges. Age range from 23 to 54. Educational attainment was 9th grade to 10th grade. Currency literacy levels, 1st grade to 9th grade in that group. So it's going to be tough, but they want to try it, and they have really bought into the program. I understand it has been quite a fact. Fact, Alamance County will become the only 3rd non-detention center in North Carolina to have a GED program. The others are Guilford and Mecklenburg counties, and they have had a high rate of success. Class logistics. Class will meet in the detention center classroom twice weekly for 2.5 hours. The GED is self-paced. Some inmates may move through the lessons faster than others. Enrollment will be capped, and of course we've got 11, but will be continuous. A wait list will be developed in any event an inmate withdraws from class or messes up, another one will be brought in his place. If they have not completed class at their time of release, they will be referred to ACC to continue to get their GED degree. I know y'all are saying, Sheriff, where is the money? Where is the beef?
We always want to know that.
And I knew that'd be a question, yes, so I'm going to tell you. It's going to cost us $3,310.24, and that is coming from our SCALP money, which is State Criminal Alien Assistance Program, which that money is mandated to be used in that detention center for programs or needed equipment to help with the inmate population. So that is no cost. I mean, we're getting that money. Y'all don't have to approve that money. Any questions?
Do we need to approve the program?
I think.
Really, you don't have to, but I wish you would.
I move that we do, you know, there's a, yeah. I move that we do.
And I'll second your motion.
There is an organization in the community you probably know about, Sustainable Alamance, right. And Phil Bowers.
And Phil Bowers is our instructor.
Well, that's great, because this feeds right into what that organization is doing, and this would be a tremendous, and meets a tremendous need.
And I have talked to some business people that have told me if they graduate, they will hire them if they have positions open.
That's great.
We have a motion and a second to approve the program. And the moving of the money, which you will take care of in the scout.
Yes, sir.
All those in favor signify saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Sheriff.
And I want to thank you, Sheriff. I think that's the best thing you've done this week.
Thank you, Mayor.
All right.
You know it's just Monday.
I'm giving you some oopsies for the week.
All right, next we have a strategic plan update. Libby Hodges, plan director, and Commissioner Bird.
You can. I'm gonna let Libby start.
You can stay where you at.
Okay.
I'm here today to present a brief update on the status of the Destination 2020 plan, as well as to ask you to set a date for a strategic plan scoping retreat. Just to go over it very briefly, the review was built on a previous review completed by the planning department from 2011. I'm not going to get into the fine details. I've given you all a lovely 35-page packet that gives you more information about each recommendation and how it's been achieved. There's also additional information about obstacles that we may have run into, different programs that are happening. I've tried to present a pretty comprehensive look at how we go about doing some of our business. To better understand our progress in this plan, I've done what's called an achievement score for each implementation action recommended by the Destination 2020 plan. There were 20 categories of recommendations and 135 recommendations, so it was pretty, it was a lot. As outlined in page 2 of your packet, we have a success rate of around 47% so far. A few categories I'd like to point out of note are agricultural and rural area preservation, solid waste management, parks and recreation, services to senior citizens, and health care, who have excellent completion rates. It's kind of small, but you can see kind of on the right-hand side. There's only one 100% in health care, so I would like to commend all of them on their work so far. All of this was done in preparation for a new countywide strategic plan, and in order to help us create this strategic plan, excuse me, we've coordinated a workshop with the School of Government Strategic Public Leadership Initiative. This workshop would help us identify the scope of the project as well as major topics of concern and help us identify the final product that we would like to create. This meeting would be open to the public as required by law. The very last page of your packet is going to have a proposed agenda. This may change as we work towards get closer to the date. But the tentative date that we've set is going to be August 28th. And we are.
That's a Friday, I believe.
That is a Friday. Mm-hmm. That is a Friday. If that date doesn't work, we're likely looking at late October, so that pushes us back a bit due to all of our time constraints. We've discussed using a conference room at Cancer Center.
Alamance Regional Cancer Center.
Excuse me.
Well, it's Cone Health, Alamance Regional. Really nice room, very comfortable.
But
good acoustics, you can hear well in that room.
But the location is still to be determined. So if you have any questions or comments.
Well, I would just like to say that I think this is really important that we seriously start down this path of doing a strategic plan. With my background as a planner for the hospital, I know how valuable that it is. Several weeks ago, Craig and Libby and I went down to the School of Government to meet with Lydia Altman, The school of government has this, like Libby mentioned, the Strategic Public Leadership Initiative, and it helps. Its purpose is to help local governments do this strategic planning. And you think, well, why do we need a whole day just to get started? And if you look at the agenda, I mean, these things take time. You know, we want to make sure that we're all on the same page about what a strategic plan can do for us. We want to review the results of a Destination 2020. And that was done a long time ago. I think it was 2003.
Yeah.
So it's been a long time since we've done
that.
And, you know, plans, if first, you know, we need to have a vision about where we want to be as a community, as a county, or as a county government. And then we need to have a plan to get there. And if we don't have those two things, then we're just kind of wandering out there without any direction at all. So that's why it's so important. But we can be talking about that at the retreat, review what's been accomplished. I know, Commissioner Smith, you were really interested in making sure we weren't reinventing the wheel, that we, you know, we have a plan in place, and we can walk through that and just to make sure we're on track. But look at what exists, the assets in our community. What are those emerging critical issues that we need to be worried about in the future? What's our long-term vision? And how should, what is the process? And you know, I've been through a whole bunch of these kinds of sessions, and they're really valuable, and they do take time, but we need to decide who should be involved. How extensive do we want to do community meetings? What staff should be involved in this process? What should be our timeline? And all these other issues that are associated with planning. So it would be a really worthwhile day. It'll be very interesting. I think everybody would find it very interesting. So I was very impressed with Lydian Altman, the director of that leadership initiative. And she's got a lot of planning experiences, and she's helped a lot of local governments go through this process. And it's very cost effective. Even if we decide not to use her as a consultant sort of through the whole process, at least we can get kick-started on this day just to help us decide how far do we want to go with this.
Sounds good. So the 28th of August, is it?
Yes, sir. What we would do, once we get the date and time, we'll set up the details and get the information back to you. We will work with Libby. Also, we're going to put a copy of this on our website. It'll be on the planning link, on the planning page as a link. So we'll hope to encourage the citizens to review this as well. It's got a lot of great information in it. One of the things that Libby has really done and done a lot is really identify with our department heads what we've done well and where do we need to do improvements and where have we made some good strides based on the 2020 plan. So we do have a good base, and again, we're also identifying our outside partners as well, from nonprofits to municipalities, you name it. We've tried to identify everybody that we touch with respect to county government and how we can work with them and how our plan is comprehensive with their plan and our expectations are working together. So it's been a fun process to this point. And once we agree on the date, and there will be a cost with the Institute of Government coming in, I believe it's
$2,500.
Again, this is just for a one-day event. That's part of the day, but also there's a lot of pre-planning work for her to get ready for this meeting. So there is a cost that will be associated with that. So this will define where we want to go and what our next steps are, and we do need that help as we move forward.
Very good. I'm good with that date. If you need a motion on it or any consensus, whatever.
Consensus is August 28th. Whatever time's convenient.
You good with that?
I'm good with that.
Okay.
All right.
Is that here?
Yeah,
we're not sure.
Yeah, we'll give you the details of after that. Once we got the date, we'll probably, Bob said the hospital will probably be open for free. So we're looking for...
I'm sure there would be no charge at the hospital. That's part of the hospital's community.
Bob may still have old connections.
Greensboro and other places.
Tell them you're coming back, Bob, and they'll probably...
But I just ask that it's a nice place that we can be comfortable. It'd be conducive for free thinking and, you know, good conversation.
That is
acoustics nice are good so that we can hear each other, and the restrooms are clean.
And it's still open. It'll be large enough that if the public does want to attend, they are invited to attend as well.
All right. Thank you. All right. Next, we have the proposed Alamance County Department's 2015-2016 management goals. And Brian, you've given it to us, and we've read it, so you can be as brief as you'd like to.
Certainly. I hope you've had a chance to look these goals over. All 24 Alamance County departments are participating. Total number of goals is 187, which is a little different than what you found in the original. I provided you with the two other departments that were left out of the original plan. So, you know, these goals are important to the departments. They'll be working on them, if you approve this evening, throughout the year. They set goals. They also report workload measures, which is things like how many permits, how many activities they did in this fiscal year 15-16. And this year, for the first time, the board has said in the past that they've been interested in us trying to find ways to benchmark, compare ourselves to other folks, to other units. We do have five departments that will be tracking workload measures that are comparable to the North Carolina Local Government Performance Measurement Project. We're not a part of that. Basically, we just pulled some measurements out of that and gave them to CCOM, our 911 center, Fire Marshal's Office, Human Resources, the Inspections Department, and Recreation and Parks. Just to let you know, we are going to be bringing to the board at the second meeting in August a revised performance management policy. So County Manager's Office, Finance, Human Resources have met. We've looked over the existing policy. We have some recommendations we'll be bringing you to change that policy. We would like an opportunity to look at it in light of the audit findings for the end of 14-15. But if you approve those changes, when we bring them to you in August, they would apply to fiscal year 15-16. And we think you'll find them satisfactory. But also, one other note before I ask you for your approval on these goals. While we're attending the NACO conference in Charlotte, we found some software, ICMA software. ICMA and SAS have gotten together, together a very nice way to track these goals, to benchmark our department's goals with units all across the country. It was very impressive. I think Mr. Honeycutt's going to be lining up a visit to Rockingham County. They use the software. We're going to go up there and meet with them, see how they like it. There is a cost for it, but what we would recommend to you if we decide to go with it is that we take that cost from the pool of savings that the department's generating. You know, this program has two sides, savings and goals. So we think we could do that, not cost any new county dollars. We would spread it out among the departments to pay for, because it would be in the best interest of everyone participating in the program. So hope that was brief enough.
That was good.
If you have any questions about the goals, I'll be happy to try to answer.
I would like to comment. I was at that NACO meeting, and I was with Brian at the booth that had the software. And I've been one of my frustrations being a commissioner when we go through the budget process is that we don't have good comparative data. In the hospital business, we had great comparative data from hospitals all over the country. We could benchmark against efficiency data, cost data, and, how are we supposed to know how many sheriff deputies we should have? Sheriff, I mean, not to pick on you, but...
I'm
Well, I really wasn't out there in opinion, I think.
But this would be a great tool. I think this would, if it turns out to be what I hope it is.
How long has Rockingham been using this?
Fairly new software,
yeah,
I believe.
ICMA is the International City County Managers Association, so the software is really built for managers and practitioners to really look at benchmarking and to look at performance measures. So Rockingham County, I think, in the last 6 months has implemented the software. So the county manager is a good friend of mine, so we're going to try to ride up there and take a visit. And Bob would love for you to come if you'd like to come.
I'd love to come if I'm available.
And then in the next meeting, we'll cover the changes in terms of the performance.
Actually, it'll be the second meeting in August, sir. That'll give us time to look at the year-end closeouts from 14-15, because we're going to propose, I don't want to tip the hand here, but we're going to propose some changes to some of the percentages and some of the way things are calculated. We want to make sure we can lay it down on those accurate end-of-year numbers and make sure that it works before we bring it to you. We knew that had been a concern from all of them, so.
Especially looking at how we could increase that fund balance number, so before full implementation.
So you need a motion and you need a passage that we approve these performance management goals tonight.
Yes, sir.
They'll have a motion.
A motion.
Second.
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Item number five, discussion of the creation of a county facilities committee. County Manager Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In discussion with Chairman Engel, who sits on the ACC Board of Directors, they have a facilities committee. The Board of Trustees, excuse me, Algie will beat me up later. but they have a facilities committee, and the committee looks at a lot of in-depth issues that sometimes the board may not have the time to, because a lot of these issues that we have coming up in front of us with respect to what do we do with our inspections in the modular unit, what do we do with the old environmental health building, where are we going to go, what buildings need to be saved, what buildings can we tear down, it really is going to require a lot of work, a lot of insight, and really board buy-in before we move forward with anything, because Brian and I do not want to present you a plan that we think is the greatest since sliced bread without the board having buy-in with that plan beforehand. So we would like to form a facilities committee with the Board of Commissioners. Again, we have 500,000 square feet of facilities under a roof that we're responsible for. And trying to juggle around the needs of departments plus cost is really like a huge jigsaw puzzle. So it's a lot of work and a lot of options coming up. You know, we may have property donated to us. So how does that best fit? And we would like to create that committee. And once that committee is created, it would be an open meeting since it is a board-appointed committee. But we would get a lot more in detail with respect to facilities and next steps and what's in the best interest of the county. Really part of our strategic plan also as we move forward.
Yeah, facilities should be a part of the plan.
I would like for the vice chair and myself to serve on that committee also. I think that would be appropriate. So if you'll go ahead and just continue on and report back to us next time.
Mr. Chairman, could there be a motion to that effect?
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Absolutely. You've heard, is there any further discussion?
I
was excited.
I would just assume the chairman appoint the committee. We should give him the authority and let him appoint the committee.
So we pretty much took care of it, didn't we?
I'm sorry.
I make a motion we go do that, Judge, or we join the
motion. I'll second it. Thank you, Judge. So actually, we don't need a vote then. We just appoint it. Thank you, Judge.
And what we'll do is we're going to start on this really ASAP, and we will get with both of you. But again, we'll let the rest of the board know the activities, when we're meeting, if you'd like to be a part of it. But we're going to start this fairly quick.
Yep. Thank you. Item number six, for the essence of time, I would ask unless there's some indifference on the board, that we just postpone that until the next meeting. That sound okay with everybody? Hearing none, then we'll postpone item number six. Budget amendments, Ms. Saunders, and please come up to Health Department. Looks like they're all three pretty related, too, aren't they?
Yes. Well, somewhat.
Oh, okay.
So the first that I bring to you is for Ebola preparedness response funding. The North Carolina Division of Public Health is allocating Ebola preparedness and response funds across the state. And the Alamance County Health Department was allocated $20,000 from the North Carolina Division of Public Health for this purpose. As you're probably well aware, during 2015, and part of 2014, Ebola became a top national priority of the CDC and therefore became a top state and local priority as well. And the purpose of this funding is to enhance that local public health preparedness piece and the operations around Ebola preparedness. So Ebola has now become part of what we do at the health department and across the state and in other local health departments. And we've been creating policies and procedures around that and amending our own current policies and procedures. And been working with our local emergency management, EMS, and our local law enforcement who have been outstanding. I can't say that enough. And so this funding also helps us collaborate with those entities to create policies and procedures for that as well. So these are all entirely state funds, and they do not require a local match.
No. I'm good with it. I make a motion that we
approve all. Approve three?
Yeah.
All right. I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Thank you.
Thank you. So the second one, the next two are foundation grants and funding from grant process. So the Alamance County Health Department was awarded $7,000 from Impact Alamance, our newly created foundation from the Cone Health Alamance regional merger, to be used for Healthy Mothers, Healthy Babies, which is our coalition to reduce infant mortality and improve child health outcomes in our county. And the money is going for our Cribs for Kids and our Alamance County Health Department Baby Closet. These funds will be used to purchase 60 Graco pack-and-plays, which are safe sleep environments, and 50 car seats to be provided to Alamance County families in need of safe sleep and safe travel systems. So the safe sleep, back to sleep, tummy to play is an evidence-based education aimed at reducing SIDS and infant mortality in our, in not only our community, but across the state and across the nation. And so we're at, these are also foundation grant monies that don't require a local match.
Motion to approve.
Second. Motion second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Thank you. Third.
And the third one is also a foundation grant from the North Carolina Dental Health Endowment. The Alamance County Health Department was awarded $1,710 from the North Carolina Dental Health Endowment, and these funds will be used to purchase equipment to help and assist in the sealant process at our Alamance County Dental Children's Clinic, and no local match is required.
Questions? Motion?
Motion to approve.
Second. Motion second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Opposed? No. Thank you.
Thank you all
Stacey,
so much.
Thank you for that you. Hard work to get that to happen.
Thank you.
3 weeks into our budget year, and we've got three amendments already.
I know. But no cost to the county.
No cost. Next, we have update video from the NCACC.
Mr. Chairman, I know Judge Smith is would not be too upset if I decided to delay that video. Judge, would you be okay with
it? I just woke up. What was that?
With the board, we will review the video at another time. And the only thing that I really have for the manager's update is in the last week, we had our quarterly soil war breakfast where we recognized our employees who were nominated for the soil war. This is our employee recognition for the quarter. And we would like to recognize our quarterly winner, Ms. Jana Elliott from the health department.
Well deserved.
And if I could read her nomination. An employee submitted a request for training at a very late date, and since it was out of town travel, requested an ASAP turnaround time frame from the Board of Commissioners. Jana stayed late one night, a few hours after all Board of Commissioners requests were in and submitted, and asked for the exception so that the employee request could be addressed at the next board meeting, and the travel was granted. Jen is especially valued in her HR work because of her ability to be professional in executing her duties and, in the same time, honest about the situation. Most remarkable, in my opinion, is that she constantly has a buoyant attitude and pulls people up into that positive frame of experience more than often than not. She is diligent in responding to requests, meets those challenging budget deadlines as well. In addition to the qualities mentioned above, Dan is engaged in the public health mission of the organization as opposed to someone who addresses budget and HR issues with a detached approach. She communicates these values frequently, as in the role of MC at staff meetings and in the individual conversation. Anybody who knows Jana knows that she can quite literally do anything. She is known as a public health first responder. If a coworker is needed, she finds a way to stretch herself to help, guide, or facilitate resources. She thrives on challenges. Jana is direct, yet kind and nurturing. She is the ultimate team player. So, Jana Elliott, you are our
Need a speech, Jan.
Well, I'll say, since I'm representing commission on the Board of Health, I'll speak to her friendliness and competency and her service orientation. So.
And having served on that board, she is very efficient,
very efficient.
I have to say.
Thank you.
Yes.
Any further?
Doug, thank you.
All right, Commissioner's comments. I've got one at the end, but I'll everybody.
I'm done commenting.
I think we're commented out.
Okay, I've got about
an hour and a half.
Judge, this won't take long.
Y'all can go ahead. I listen anyway, so y'all can go ahead.
And you listen closely too, Mr. Albright, on this one. I have been very tolerant of Tony Cox with the meetings since December, more so than Judge Smith. And tonight, for the final time in any recent history, he's attacked another county commissioner personally, and that was Linda. That was you, and I do not appreciate that. I gaveled him, but I think it's got to the point where maybe we need to send Mr. Cox home for 6 months. Mr. Albright, is that something that we can do as a board? Do we need to vote on it?
We have a resolution to prohibit him from participating in public comment period until he can adjust his behavior. I'll prepare a resolution.
All right, sir. So we need to vote on it tonight. Any further discussion on what I just said? All right,
I'm good with it.
All those in favor of suspending Tony's rights to come and speak and be at the meeting for 6 months, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. All right. Any further business? Meeting is adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.